Well, thank you, George, for introducing. And yeah, I think it's really nice that in this Studium Generale, there's also a bit of a focus away from the immediate environment, because clearly COVID-19, as most infectious diseases, they are not really confined to a specific situation. They do not know borders. So thank you already for the introduction, Joyce, but who am I? I don't know you, but I understand most of you are medical students. I did my medical training at the VU, then I became a tropical doctor, and afterwards an arts MNG, so public health. I worked for several years in sub-Saharan Africa, first with MSF in Sudan and Uganda, and then with Nemisa in Zambia and a mission hospital. That was more the clinical part of my trajectory. Afterwards, I switched more to research. I did my MPH in Hopkins, and then I worked for a long time at the Medical Research Council in the Gambia, and also did my PhD there. Then I switched to public health. I went to the RIVM, where I was heading the Center for Epidemiology and Surveillance of Infectious Diseases, and I joined the Julius Center. And since 3 years, I moved to Antwerp, and that's now a border with border controls, where I'm heading the Department of Public Health. So COVID in the world, and this is, I think, an update from yesterday, and clearly COVID is all over the world. It's very rare here in Europe, but that's, this is numbers, and Europe happens to have many countries. But you can see also Africa, Asia, Africa, in the Americas, there's hardly any country left which is not affected by COVID. This is a timeline which gives a bit more indication, not just of blobs, and clearly in epidemiology, it's always time, place, and person. You can see it started in China. There's a strange blob here, which is due to changing the case definition. So for comparing between countries and over time, it's always quite relevant to know, is it counted in the same way? Clearly, then there's a lot in the, you see, this is the Americas. Here we have Europe, in between Asia, and a very small blue line, which is COVID in Africa. Now, why is that? If we try to look differently, and not just numbers, but trying to take account of the population, how many cases are there per 100,000, we see clearly that in the north, it's much more dark than in the south. And if we take a bit closer look, how is it growing? What is the, in the last 14 days? Also there, we see kind of a similar pattern. It's growing more in the north than in the south, in particular in Asia, China, and Africa. So what's special about Africa? COVID is an example of a newly emerged infection. And most new infections in humans, they have a zoonotic origin. Most new infections, they are of zoonotic origin, meaning they make a jump from the animal host to the humans, and they are when they are successful, they can spread between humans. And many of these jumps are not successful, then the humans are a dead end host. But if they are successful and they are not contained, they can spread all over the world. There are several drivers. First of all, those related to increasing contact between animals and humans. They are related to changes in the climate, in populations of animals and humans, using the land or agriculture, and behavior both of animals and particularly of humans. Then there are some drivers which are more related to transmission. And they are mainly because we have a lot of global travel and trade of animals, of humans, of vegetables, of plants. Lucky bamboo was also a good example of spreading of infections, of vectors in that case. Then there is our global factors related to vulnerability. That means that the clinical outcomes, they are worse when people are more vulnerable. That can be at the individual level, but also at population level. finally, the current communications with social media, with satellites, it goes really rapid. So that's of importance when you think about interventions and knowledge transfer. All this makes whatever happens in one part of the world very rapidly relevant for all other parts as well, or at least potentially relevant. Now, one of the questions is, which also was in the previous epidemiological slides, is are tropical areas, particularly Africa, are they less affected than other areas? So this is a slide looking at the incidence also per million people. So it's corrected for population density. And you can see that these are all lines going up after it takes a while, then exponentially shooting up for Europe and the Americas. And that these lines, which are mainly in tropical areas of Southeast Asia, that they remain very low. Now, of course, with any graph, with all data, it's always the question, is it true? And if so, what could be reasons for it? So are areas in the tropics, are they less affected than areas in more temperate climates? There are some reasons to think, yes, they are less affected. For example, populations are much younger, in particular in Africa. You can see that very few countries have more than 5% of people over the age of 70. Most have only like 1%. In the Americas, you see a bit a bimodal distribution with around 5% and around 10 to 15%. In Asia, it's most of them are quite young, except Japan, where over 20% is over the age of 70. Europe is an old continent, and Italy is really on the top with 17.5% of the population being aged 70 or above. And then in Oceania also, Australia is relatively with an older population. So you would think if there's younger populations, we know that the most mortality at least is in most severe diseases in elderly people with comorbidities, which often goes together, age and comorbidities. Which also means that many of the old people who die now, they may have been in a poor condition. They might have died already within the coming weeks or months, maybe. They die sooner because of COVID, but they would have died maybe in the near future. With younger populations, that is not likely to happen. Other reasons, it's the climate, and there's some data, this is from SARS-1, that has been replicated, or some studies that if it's more hot and humid, the virus doesn't survive so well, meaning the transmission will be less, and therefore people will be less affected. Other reasons could be that, kind of a blessing in disguise, many of the tropical countries have a lot of practical experience and preparedness with outbreaks, which can be really devastating for their populations. That's infectious diseases like cholera, Ebola, etc. But it's also outbreaks or infectious disease problems related to insecurity, to war, to displaced people, populations, to hunger. So some people think because people in Africa are much more used, or people in other tropical countries, it will be easier to adapt behavior and to implement measurements. Then in general, there's a very high degree of BCG vaccination, and some people also think that the non-specific effect of live vaccines, in particular BCG, they give a boost, a non-specific boost to your immune system, which is, can be beneficial for COVID also. And a final reason is that the number of introductions, the seeding introductions, is far less, because in general, the connectiveness of the global world is much more in the north than in the south. So in at least in Africa, it's very much seen as a disease of the VIPs, of the people who can go to Europe or fly all over the world. And indeed, many of the first introductions came from the richer neighborhoods. And for example, the lockdown in Kinshasa, it is only the rich neighborhood which which is very easily lockable, because before this was already put into place as a way to provide security to the diplomats. Now it's to provide security to the rest of the population. However, there are also many reasons to think why this is only a matter of time, and that in the end, it's these countries who will be worst affected. First of all, because the basic health system is not strong. And this map shows where there are critical shortages in staff. And clearly, that's the same tropical countries. That has nothing to do with climate. That has to do with lack of resources, lack of training, limited facilities. Another reason why tropical countries might be more affected is that if the virus gets hold, the reduction of exposure, which is the mainstay of our efforts in the north at the moment, are much more limited. Housing is very crowded, running water is a luxury, electricity may not be available. In general, populations are also more vulnerable. They are not as well nourished. Besides many infectious diseases, which are highly prevalent, there's also high prevalences of diabetes, of hypertension. So they are already challenged. There's many countries' political instability, and surveillance is not very strong. It might mean that the data are not really correct, because if you do not measure it, it doesn't exist. If you do not test, it doesn't exist. So there is a lot of worries that the situation may be worse than the data show. On the other hand, there are not really reports of hospitals and health centers being overrun with people who are very sick, or with bodies piling up in the villages, which suggests that the current data, they may not be correct, but they are not hiding a major disaster happening due to the direct effects of COVID at the moment. Now, these are some specific problems for low resource settings, but they're also global vulnerabilities. They are also true in the Netherlands and in many countries. The public health and healthcare in many countries is not sufficiently funded. It's not considered sexy, it's not considered urgent, it's considered a given. And I think also in the Netherlands and other countries, people hope that this crisis, that one of the things it will bring is that people who are making such decisions really realize how important it is to invest in that. The fragile supply chains and the interdependency is also a vulnerability. Then clearly, in an individualized society where everybody is an expert, the Netherlands used to have 70 million football coaches. Now it seems there's 70 million COVID experts. There's a lot of distrust in science and authorities, and everybody is having opinions, making it very hard to sometimes make evidence-based decisions based on the facts as they are known at that moment. Vulnerable groups, they are being marginalized in many societies. They are more seen as a risk than as groups we should care about. Which in the case of infectious diseases is really not very smart either, because transmission always depends on your weakest link. If you try to eliminate or to control an infection in certain neighborhoods only, you will always be at risk if you do not take a population approach, because transmission, it will just cross any socioeconomic borders. Another global vulnerability is that it turns out to be, in spite of very good intentions, that coordination and collaboration to address all the many unknowns of a new emerging pandemic is very difficult. This is both scientific and political. People seem to, it's difficult to listen and to share people seem to very much believe in their own judgment without being open to learn and to criticize. Of course, the information overload doesn't really help. It's almost impossible to keep up with the literature and then to weigh the literature. There's a whole explosion of preprints, which is very good if you think information should be available quickly, but it's a concern if you think the quality should also be assessed. And of course, fake news, that doesn't really help neither to build trust nor for the people who have to take decisions to get a good view, to make a good assessment. And finally, I think it's a vulnerability that there seems to be a lot of people try to blame others. And this is not just what's the cause, but also for taking interventions in time or too late or too little. That relates a bit to the defensiveness that can be part of people not finding it difficult to say, we all have to learn, we're all in this together, we all make mistakes. It's a very defensive attitude, which is not, people say they all want to collaborate, but in practice, in science and in politics, that is not really easy. So what do we do? I think this is a well-known summary of in the absence of a vaccine, and clearly the vaccine may come or may not come. For HIV, we still don't have a vaccine after 40 years of trying. Treatments, antivirals have not been very successful so far, except for HIV in this case, but not easy like a bacteria or some of the other infections we have. So what we do in the meantime is to try to make sure that at least the health system can handle what the people who need the healthcare. And clearly the level of this line, it will really differ by society. What can a health system cover, cope with? So there are kind of general test, treat, trace, isolate. These are kind of the principles the WHO has been advocating on a global scale from the beginning. So also the Africa CDC, who really takes up a leadership role, they have been making this guidance quite early in the pandemic, also saying test and treat and isolate. But we have to reflect what this means in practice. This is in Nigeria. Yeah, that was a lockdown, but clearly in these houses, it's quite difficult to have a whole family sit together. There's no running water. There's a lot of pollution. People have to, this is kind of a broad street, but the implications of a lockdown for a specific society can be quite different. This is India, where the lockdown meant that people were going to take long distances walking back home, because otherwise they would have no food. With a lockdown, it means no work, and then it means no income, and that means immediate stop of any resources. So is it one size fits all for these interventions? The things we work on, physical distancing, some people call it social distancing, but I think the social distancing is what we try to avoid. It's about physical distancing. But clearly the capabilities to do that, it will depend on the density of the populations, the environment. Is it in a slum? This is completely different than in an apartment or in a house in the woods. For quarantine, it can be a luxury in the absence of housing, electricity, and running water, or where you need to go out to earn a living every single day. At the same, and also increased hygiene, that implies that water and soap or disinfectants, they are available and they are affordable, that it's not a choice between either soap or food. So one size fits all, that's rarely the case. The Then, of course, there are local interventions. So this is Kinshasa, where the government, and Kinshasa is one of these countries where the epidemic was, is mainly contained still in the richer neighborhoods, the diplomats. So the government took to spraying all the cars. Clearly, that's wasting kind of precious water in a town, in a city with a lot of water shortages elsewhere. It's creating aerosols, which is not great if you want to reduce transmission. So not all local interventions are great either. You also see it in treatments, that some countries now start to treat with herbal treatments. They may work, they may not work, but without proper investigation, it can do more harm than good. So this is a bit the catch-22. Because some people say, well, we see the epidemic take off less in the tropics. And that's because so early and so strongly we imposed all these lockdowns. So we should continue these lockdowns in spite of the hardship for people to stick to it and in spite of all the implications. But other people say, well, there's really no need for these lockdowns because there is far less transmission in Africa, far less people getting sick. It's not necessary, it can be stopped, it should be stopped. And of course, some people say, well, these restrictions, they are they also have other purposes than to stop COVID-19. It's also for maybe other reasons for the people who implement them. Then another debate is, well, if we say one size doesn't fit all, we should we say lockdowns, they are for high income countries and not for poorer populations where they cannot maintain that, where it doesn't enable them to continue their life. But then of course that gets, if you have a differential treatment in that way, there's always concerns, is this neocolonialism, is this rational? Oh, is it too early to say that there should be differential? And when would it be too late? And of course, some countries say also in high income countries, we are overshooting with the lockdowns. They do more harm than good. And then people, and also WHO is now also pointing to Sweden where they went for a much softer lockdown. The problem is, of course, that nobody knows what is the benefit, but we're all seeing the harms. And the harms, they are much more clear in poorer countries, in tropical countries, than in the high-income countries. But also in the high-income countries, the burden seems to be much harder on people who are less well-off or vulnerable than on other people. So this were a bit the non-pharmaceutical interventions, the prevention. Clearly, when it comes to more the clinical side, also there you can wonder, one size fits all, is that the most appropriate intervention? For testing, it means you need supply, but you also need qualified staff. You need to make sure the tests, they can stand the heat and the humidity. If you have tests, you have to decide who to test, when to test, where to test, what specimens to test, how often to test. It asks a lot of data to make a good policy, to divide always scarce resources, to make sure you get the results, reliable results on which people can act. The same goes for treatment. If you have treatment, you have to make sure that people can access it, that it's not that it's affordable for them, and also that the quality is good. So that's for supportive care, but also to make sure the hygiene is good. If you get patients coming to health centers and hospitals, and that's where they get infected, then you do more harm than good. There's a lot of talk about ventilators, that there's hardly any ventilators in sub-Saharan Africa, but maybe it's much more important to focus on the oxygen, because clearly that's where a much larger population will benefit from that. It's also much lower cost, much more easy to get there. Particularly if we also think that in general, so far, it seems to be less severe. fewer people will be needing ventilators. But if we don't have oxygen, people will shoot right through. So we have to make sure these bottom and middle layers are well supported, which is much easier than focusing on the top layer. Then the treatments. Nobody knows what is an effective treatment at the moment. There's trials ongoing. They are called solidarity trials. They are looking at HIV medications, because these antivirals we know. They've looked at influenza treatments. They are no longer used. Chloroquine has been promoted. Remdesivir, which failed for Ebola, but maybe it works now. There's a lot of money to be made, clearly. It's also in trials, people try to look for new drugs, but also try to reuse old drugs like chloroquine. And another aspect is, of course, using treatment as a prevention before you become sick or maybe exposed. And for example, this has been suggested also for chloroquine. Many people going to the tropics have been taking chloroquine for a long time as a prevention against malaria. So some people say, can we not take it as prevention against COVID-19? Of course, that's only makes sense if we know it works. Then vaccines. Yes, so if they are available, who will get the first vaccines? Who will benefit first? And how can we assess well if indeed these live vaccines, if they have non-specific effects which could be beneficial? So trial for BCG are ongoing, but there are also live vaccines. And for example, yellow fever has been used a lot in many tropical countries. At the same time, many countries are struggling with even the struggling to provide even the most basic health services for their populations. And clearly that's a major concern, because something on top of it, I mean, that's the same argument we discussed before, because health services in general are not as strong. It is more difficult if something happens to sustain it. What we saw in the Netherlands, rapid scaling up of hospitals, of municipal health services. That's very unlikely if your basic health systems are not in decent shape. So one size may not fit all, but it means we need very good data which are specific for in a specific period of the epidemic, for populations and for a certain context. Because the weakest link is a risk for all. In that way, it's really global health. And the WHO calls this leaving no one behind. That's out of solidarity, but it's also out of self-interest if you talk about infectious diseases. And probably also for other reasons, if the inequity increases, in the end, that's a threat for everyone. So we need data on what the virus does, what the immune system does, what the clinical outcomes are for not just in China or in Europe or America. We also need to such data in Africa. We need to understand better the risks of the transmission and how the virus is transmitted. We need that in the Netherlands. We need, for example, to understand that in nursing homes. But we also need that very much to understand in African settings, where households are completely different than in high-income settings, where healthcare facilities have completely different infrastructure, limitations, and strengths. We need to understand what are correlates of protection. That can be quite different depending on how the immune system is primed by other infections, by other vaccinations, between different populations. Because only if we know what are correlates of protection, we can have good proxies to study this for vaccinations, for drugs, saying who is more or less protected and who is at risk. We need data on the interventions. They should be effective and safe, but they should also be acceptable for a population, and it must be able to deliver them to the people who need it. we need to understand what is the impact on the routine health services, because clearly COVID-19 is one problem, there are many other health problems. So we need studies which describe the problem, which test interventions, evaluate them, and these studies need to be fast, they need to be of good scientific quality, and they need to ask the relevant questions for specific studies. Now, that seems to make sense, but it's not always so easy. This is an example of a study on BCG vaccine, and two French scientists, they gave an interview where they were being asked, should you not include also African populations in this? So they agreed to that, and they said, yes, we definitely need to include them also, because they are very vulnerable and they are often unprotected, meaning they are not so able to protect themselves through social distancing, physical distancing. And then they made the comparison that doing HIV studies on commercial sex workers in sub-Saharan Africa was also a very efficient way to understand what worked and didn't work. Now that gave a very strong backlash. So this is a famous footballer. Like, if Africa is not a testing lab, the WHO said this is a hangover from colonial mentality. A lot of Twitter comments that this was very racist. Well, the principle that if you have an intervention which might work, that you should test this in different populations, this makes a lot of sense. You don't want to give an intervention which is effective in population A to population B without knowing, well, you're aware there's a different background that they could work, but you need to test this to be sure you do more good than harm. So for example, in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, they were already preparing to participate in a trial on vaccinations. And because of this backlash, they were more or less forced to put this at least temporarily on hold. Because this is very sensitive, this is already from the Ebola days, that using a placebo in randomized control trials gives a lot of opposition in many countries. They feel that this is using populations as guinea pigs. Clearly, from a scientific point of view, if you do not have a placebo comparison, it's very difficult to say if you don't find a difference, if everything works or if nothing works, or if the treatments are worse than a placebo. So it is not easy to do studies in different settings if you do not really do a very careful involvement of the people who need to apply, who can define the questions, the relevant questions, and need to apply the solutions. Then we're talking about COVID-19, but actually there's a lot of collateral damage, both from the infection, but even more from the response. So we see that also in the Netherlands, the health services, they become under a lot of pressure, meaning that care and prevention, which are also essential, the demand hasn't changed, the need hasn't changed, but people either do not come or they cannot get the services they need. With healthcare workers who get overburdened, particularly if they are already overburdened and understaffed, the quality may suffer, not apart from the access. Then a lot of these interventions, we do not really know how well they work. So they're sometimes started because of as a trial, but they may have short-term effects, trials will find them, but long-term effects, we do not know. That's of course, particularly with vaccines, we know, or with drugs, sometimes it takes a long time and very wide-scale use before relatively rare effects become known. Then COVID and the interventions, they give a lot of stress, and these also affect the most vulnerable most, both in the Netherlands and other countries, but also on the global scale. And the risk is that the inequity in the world will increase, which in the end reduces health security for all. So one of the side effects of reduction in the regular health services is that a lot of the poverty-related infectious disease mortality that can likely increase a lot, that needs a short-term approach. It's a bit different. Well, your hypertension needs to be regulated, but if your TB treatment is interrupted, the chances of you becoming a multi-drug resistant TB person and thereby putting not just yourself but many others at risk is very high. If vaccination campaigns are interrupted, this can give a lot of preventable deaths. In the Ebola campaigns, both in the Ebola outbreaks, both in West Africa and in Congo, many more children died, or many more people died of measles than of Ebola. This didn't get a lot of attention because measles is not very interesting. It's a perfect vaccine, very safe, very effective. You just have to give it. But clearly, if the people who have to give the vaccines, they are being reallocated to work on then Ebola, they cannot vaccinate. So the disease burden of these infectious diseases, they are, it's nearly all in the tropics, in low resource settings. And in that way, this is a specific warning from WHO on malaria. There's a major risk that maybe COVID in a year or 2 years, it has gone down a lot, but that these diseases have really flared up a lot. In the end, giving a major impact on mortality, not due to COVID, but indirectly, of course, it's COVID. Now, one of the major sponsors for fighting these poverty-related diseases has been Bill Gates. He's given a lot of money for the fight against polio, for the fight against malaria, for neglected tropical diseases. So now there's a lot of concerns that he's withdrawing the funding for these programs to go all to COVID. It clearly shows the vulnerability of an international health and from on philanthropic funding. This is not a democratic decision. It has been his personal decision. We were all very happy when he decided to invest so heavily on malaria, neglected tropical diseases. But clearly, he can also decide that he's going to spend this money differently. It's his money. It's not. He doesn't have to justify himself how he spends it. But it's a great vulnerability, particularly for poor countries who do not have the resources to modify that. And clearly, WHO has very little money also. Also, Gates is a big supporter of WHO. So this decision is something that here at the Institute, there's a lot of worries about that, what it might mean, not for mortality this year, but for in the coming 10, 20 years. So global health and COVID, is it global? Well, yes, but there's a lot of differences in the risk and in resilience. One size fits all, that's unlikely. And is it health, or is it really more the social and the politics around it? Because what will it mean once we are more or less immune by a vaccine or by natural immunity? Will it be a wake-up call? Will we go to a world which is more united, or will it just be back to the future? And that's, of course, the concept of health security. That's a very political concept also, because whose health are we talking about and whose security? So what's next? We will need to generate and share data, which is good evidence, so that we can act on that. We need to share resources. That's both in the direct resources for supplies, but also in funding for research and surveillance. And we have to do that in an equitable way. We need interventions which are relevant and affordable for the populations at risk. And we need to learn from them while we minimize collateral damage. We have to hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. And clearly, we need this evidence, and this is, I'm not sure, for me it's a bit small now, but this is fake news, because it's New England Journal of Medicine, but not really. It reports, this is an abstract on the use of of bleach, and it concludes there is no effect of that. Clearly this is a joke, but it shows a bit how difficult it is to get in a world where many papers are not peer reviewed, where there's a lot of fake news, where there's a lot of rumors going very rapidly. So I'd like to thank people who have given some input and inspiration, both in Utrecht and in Antwerp and abroad. And sorry, there's not too much time for questions, I see, but we had a little interruption.
Thank you, Marianne. Are there any questions?
I will start with a question. Thank you, Marianne. You talked about when testing or vaccines are available that there's going to be a choice of who's going to be vaccinated. How is this choice being made?
Sorry, can you repeat?
Sorry, you said when a vaccine will be ready to use, that in the African countries there will be a decision who will get vaccinated or not?
I think that decision will have to be made everywhere, because it's unlikely that vaccination will be available for the whole world at the same time.
And who is deciding on that?
I think that's a very interesting discussion, and I think these preparations are already ongoing. I think you what I know from in the influenza pandemic, there were lots of scenarios thought of who will we start with, and is it the people who are most vulnerable to die? Is it the people who are most likely to transmit? First of all, of course, each country has to get a share of their vaccines. Then with the influenza pandemic, some countries had preferential contracts, others didn't. There was now already in the press that like the US tried to buy a German factory to get preferential treatment. I think it shows it needs clear leadership from WHO to try to make this as equitable as possible. And it's best if discussions can start sooner rather than later. Because of course, we don't know when a vaccine will be available, if one will be available, if multiple will be available, if some will have more side effects than others, then you can also get other, who will get the first class vaccines and who will get the second class vaccines. I don't see a lot of discussion about that, but of course, just having the tool means nothing if you don't know how you want to apply the tools. And in general, if we don't discuss this before, it is the people, it is often the haves who get more and the have-nots who have to wait. It's not always sensible because it's the weakest link who is the risk for all. So maybe we should start to vaccinate those people who cannot go into quarantine. Though I'm not very optimistic that that's how it will happen.
There, maybe it's nice for everyone who is interested in these type of topics. In the research ethics and global health ethics communities, there are a lot of discussions taking place about this, or starting actually about this now. I can share a few links in the chat if you're interested. Are there other questions? Because it's nearly 7:30. I think it's worthwhile indeed to echo Lisa's comment in the chat. So Marianne, thank you very much for giving this lecture, especially after what happened. And like I said, I think it's a good reminder of how vulnerable freedom and ensuring accessibility is and can be. So I think we had a good reminder of this. I also see, so before I finish, I see one last question by Victor. Victor, would you like to ask your question?
Yes, thank you. So what I understood is that we basically trust a lot of the healthcare in Africa on NGOs like Bill Gates. And you talked a bit about what healthcare backlash also for higher income countries. And I'm wondering how that would look like, because maybe then we could raise that question and maybe start asking European governments as well as to switch up their funding for global health?
Yeah, I think you, at the moment, it's clear that a lot of the regular care also in the Netherlands has been suffering, and people are worried about that. The longer I don't think the disruption in high income countries will be as bad, but clearly, what will we do for healthcare for people who now do not have healthcare? I think there is a chance that at least in Europe, that in the near future there will be more investment in public health and in primary care and in prevention. But if this will also include more vulnerable populations, I don't know. But I think it is. There is much more a risk that there will be less money available for. That instead of more solidarity, there's more protectiveness. So people will want to spend their funding more on their own system, while this is kind of a short-term vision. Because, what I tried to explain before, it is health is really, at least infectious diseases health is very much interconnected. We cannot be safe in the Netherlands if the rest of the world isn't. Because even if you think it's far away, it's only a few flights from the Netherlands.
Okay, thank you very much for your lecture as well.
Okay, I see there was some confusion about some of the abbreviation I used. I'm sorry, that's my professional deterioration. And I think in English it's TB, and in the Netherlands it's TBC, but indeed that was tuberculosis, neglected tropical diseases. That's diseases like sleeping sickness, onchocerciasis, leishmaniasis, lepra. And together they are still highly prevalent, only they are very hidden.
Okay. It's past 7:30. At 8 there will be the memorial. So Marianne, again, thank you for joining us today. Everyone, thank you for joining too, especially after what happened. We'll work on the security. You will get an update about this tomorrow. Including new instructions how to join for tomorrow evening's lecture about human rights. So thank you very much, and have a good evening, all of you.
Thank you.